Hi, good afternoon. My name is Nishant, and thank you very much for that very generous introduction. I work at the Center for Internet and Society, which is based in Bangalore. And I want to begin both by thanking, but also congratulating Parmesh and the Godrej India Culture Lab for initiating this dialogic space where we explore and explore the ideas of what it means to engage with the world around us. I specifically will focus on two questions which have absolutely nothing to do with anything that Parmesh used in my introduction, which is how researchers work. We like to kind of surprise you and throw you off balance once in a while. But I want to kind of look at questions of technology and enchantment as an articulation against two discourses that emerge with the IT evolution and revolution in the country. The first is a discourse of mechanization that is disguised as digitization to us. It talks about in different ways of generational gaps, of collapsing social infrastructure, the shift from face to interface, and the paranoid dystopia of how all of our relationships are now going to be mediated by Facebook and Orkut. The second is what Frederick Jameson, an author I respect quite a lot, called the logic of late capitalism, which is this almost hyper-productive nature of digital technologies where everybody needs to be seen as a producer, as contributing to the world around us, as an incessant process of quantification of value, so that every click, every second you engage with the attention economy, you have to prove that you are now a legitimate prosumer, a producer plus consumer, who feeds into this postmodern globalized economy. And I posit to you enchantment then as an ideology, a non-productive superstructure which might have base material practices, but allows for subversion of certain kinds. Enchantment as offering a new way to look at our cities and the way we live in it. I must also admit that in this extremely close circle of Bombay friends, I'm possibly the token non-Bombay person, but I'm going to try and localize as much as I can. I shall begin Bollywood style, talking to you, taking you to Antwerp to talk about romance and enchantment in Bombay. Here is a phenomenon that took 2010 by storm on it for everybody who is on YouTube. As a tribute to one of my favorite movies as a child, The Sound of Music, a group of people went out in search for the new singing Maria, starting with Belgium and then spreading across the world in 37 countries, ranging from South Korea to Spain to the Philippines to the United States of America and so on. I was very tempted to make a PowerPoint presentation, but I was told by one of my 12-year-old correspondent in December that PowerPoint is so 20th century. Yes, there are people who are young enough to say these things to us now. So I'm not going to have a PowerPoint presentation, but in the new simulation form of new media aesthetic, I'm going to show you a recursive video of people dancing all around the world. The first 4 minutes with the music so that you can get a sense of what I want to talk about, and the rest of it is going to be me speaking, and when you're bored of looking at me on this large screen, you can watch people dancing. So without further ado, let me first take you to Antwerp. Where there are people who came together to search for the new Maria, but they decided to do it in an extremely productive and an innovative style. Can we play it? Okay. Can you turn off these lights? Turn off the lights.
Drink with jam and grain that will bring us back to Dover.
Okay, I'm going to mute it from now on, but you get a picture of what a flash mob looks like. And this is what I'm going to talk about. Organize, congregate, act, and disperse. This is the anatomy of a flash mob. A polymorphous set of people who are brought together through the commonality of subscribing to similar technology interfaces or gadgetry. Random emails, short messages on cell phones, discrete messages embedded in public works of art or media, blogs and wikis have now been successfully used to conjure these tenuous groups formations that transform temporarily the space that they arrive at, which is called a flash site. They convert it into something that neither the audience they perform for nor the state can comprehend, thus producing the space and conditions of social and physical illegality. This is the story of the first flash mob in India, and that's why we come to Bombay, and how it can be understood through the tropes of illegality, enchantment, and transformation. The story starts a little before the flash mob itself. In the year 2000, a shopping mall in Mumbai created a furore amongst the public. It was the first genuine shopping mall for India, the first all-American shopping mall. It was called Crossroads, which I am given to believe is shut down now. With its promises of unlimited pleasure and brand-tagged shopping, attracted a large crowd in its opening weeks. Everybody wanted to see what the mall was like. Everybody was curious about this space. Everybody wanted to be a part of this exclusive zone that clearly demonstrated that modernity and progress had finally come to us. Then everybody found out that they were not allowed to enter this mall. As the director of the mall pointed out in an interview with the Times of India on the 23rd of August 2000, Crossroads is not meant for everybody. In those days when cell phones were still a novelty and definitely a curio for the upper classes, when pagers were still struggling to find mass market, when incoming calls were not free, remember those days? Crossroads passed a stipulation which restricted people not carrying a cell phone or a credit card from entering the mall. If you wanted to enter the mall, you had to pay a fee of 50 rupees per head and thus make amends for not carrying either a piece of class, you know, plastic money or cell phone. This was the first time a public space made it very clear that the public it was looking for and attempting to effectively create was not everybody. The issue was talked about, shouted about, screamed at, and criticized by all wings of the media, who passionately analyzed this instance of discriminatory practice based on socioeconomics. Later, a public interest litigation was filed against the mall. It lost and had to throw open its doors to everyone who had been clamoring to get in ever since they found out that they were not, in fact, allowed to enter. We come to the mall again on the 4th of October, 2003, where the mall came into a limelight in a manner which it had not accounted for. This time, it was initiated by an email. About 5,000 original emails went off to people all around Mumbai and even beyond the city, asking them to have a look at a new blog called Mumbai Flash Mobs. The blog posted a form asking for a name, email address, and a mobile number. On the 3rd of October, several cell phones rang, asking people who had submitted their details in the form to check their inboxes. The eager participants glided to their accounts to find a mail that agonizingly chalked out the time and space of the meeting venue, the flash site. The information was also sent by SMSs to all the members who had volunteered. And then at exactly 5 p.m., a group of about 100 participants entered Crossroads. They screamed at the top of their voices and sold imaginary shares belonging to Reliance India. The going price was 1 rupee for those interested. They performed the garba in the middle of the mall, and then they all froze for 2 minutes, throwing entire audiences into complete strangenesses. And then without so much as a word, after 2 minutes of what I call historic histrionics, they opened their umbrellas and dispersed, leaving a trail of bewilderment and confusion as an audience of over 1,000 people watched with their jaws on the floor. This was India's first recorded flash mob. A large crowd of people who did not know each other, did not have any largely political purpose in mind, and did not really intend to extend the flash mob connections into relationships or communities, got together to perform a set of ridiculous actions at Crossroads, thus making it the first flash site in India. The first flash mob sparked off many others all around the nation, most of them marking out spaces such as multiplexes, shopping malls, gaming parlors, body shops, large commercial roads, and shopping complexes as their flash site. Bill Wasik, who is the creator of the first modern flash mob in Manhattan, in an interview looked upon the flash mob experiment as a study in behavioral psychology. He called the people who engaged in flash mobs hipsters, people who would join new or cool things for no reason or investment, but to be visible in the new trends and social fads. To a large extent, Vaseg's surface analysis seems to hold true. While flash mobs have now been used as a political weapon by several groups and activists in many areas of human rights, queer rights, feminism, political democracy, etc., flash mobs fundamentally exist like Findasiacal pre-Raphaelite art for a solipsist reason. Bijoy Venugopal, who produced one of the most celebrated accounts of the Crossroads flash mob, mentions how it was all about having some serious fun. Increasingly, the flash mob organizers in and across the country have disavowed any ideological moorings for the gathering and forcibly shelved them into the realms of entertainment or leisure. Following the banning of flash mobs in cities like Bombay, Bangalore, Delhi, even though they have invoked the right to freedom of speech and expression, the organizers and the participants have largely produced justifications by claiming to have no political agenda or inclinations in the construction or execution of flash mobs. In this repeated disavowal of the political, I read the desire for re-enchantment that flash mobs and mobsters bring with them. Flash sites defined by the organizing of the flash mobs are usually sites of globalized consumption, an enchanted world of brand names and designer lifestyles that can make you feel as perpetually disoriented as Alice was in Wonderland. These sites serve as a symbol of enchantment in the logic of the city. The new urban enchantment, if one were to look at it in globalized, post-liberalized India, is located in circuits of consumerism, where with plastic money and unlimited credit, the consuming citizen can buy all that the heart desires. However, flash mobs outside these networks of consumption and constituted by the same people who fit the bill of the citizen as imagined and promoted by the state and the market as they embrace globalization and its technologies demand a re-enchantment of the city. They force us to acknowledge the need for such public spaces to be accessible to all and provide a strong critique of the easily accepted globalized dream in which the state is so heavily investing. Flash mobs become a manifestation of how tenuously networked, fragile communities, their collaborations inspired and enabled by cyberspatial technologies, can contest the very forces that promote and proliferate these technologies. Flash mobs become a site upon which the drama of then globalization, consumption, state, and space is discursively and recursively enacted. That the flash mobs are in a condition of illegality is perhaps one of the easiest claims to prove. The very fact that the Mumbai police, for example, after the first series of flash mobs, invoked Section 37(1) of the Bombay Police Act in the name of security and safety, clearly states how flash mobs are considered outside the law in the most literal sense of the word. For people who don't know the Bombay Police Act 37(1), it basically says that a collection of four people who want to come together for an intended purpose need to take permission from the state, which effectively means for a good Gujarati like me, if my family which lives in Bombay goes to the beach, they effectively need to take the permission of the police. That's a law that exists in Bombay, by the way, right? The then Mumbai Police Deputy Commissioner of Police, The Deputy Commissioner of Police, Amitabh Gupta, contacted Rohit Tikmani, the organizer of the first flash mob and moderator of the flash mob blogging community, asking him to shut down the site and stop all further attempts at organizing flash mobs. Following the ban in Bombay, cities such as Ahmedabad, Bangalore, and Delhi have enacted similar bans within the city limits. These censoring forces look at flash mob as potentially destabilizing elements that can be misused for violent acts, such as riots and bombings by fundamentalist organizations. However, of great interest is the way in which a flash mob manages to reproduce flash sites in conditions of social as well as physical illegality to create deliberate structures of transient unintelligibility and incomprehension. The leisure infrastructure of malls and multiplexes, cafes and large shopping complexes, gaming zones and commercial roads of consumption are all aimed at the new citizenry that comes into being with this new urban economies falling into place. These spaces are not only legitimate spaces of self-expression through consumption, but also authorized spaces of public assembly and gathering. They promote an ethos of incessant consumption where the individual is also installed as a consumable product, that relates to others in the processes of consumption. They are the locations where brands, accessories, and lifestyles all come together as the figureheads of a sanitized economy, which strives to make opaque the surrounding subcultures of piracy, theft, copying, and distribution that emerge through such needle points. To belong to the space of a mall or a shopping complex, I'm proposing to you, one immediately needs to almost automatically endorse the original, the authentic, the expensive, as a way of making a conscious statement of style and lifestyle. These potential flash sites then become the spaces that the state legitimizes as the most visible and sanitized form of urbanization in contemporary cities. Flash mobs subvert this sanctity or the sanity of such spaces by compelling them into disruptive conditions of unintelligibility. Flash mobs force the other participants of the space to enter into a narrative of confusion and chaos, of turbulence, thus rendering the space of consumption incomprehensible for the very, very short time that the flash mob unfolds. Flash mobs, by rejecting the very use and expectation of the space, in spite of the heavy surveillance, state opposition, and high-tech policing, are able to distort the formulaic narrative of that space, thus creating alternative structures of resistance, of transformation, of transition. State apparatus gets completely paralyzed when faced with such a radical reconfiguring, and thus goes out of its way to put a special ban upon flash mobs in a city where even a small defeat in a cricket match or various emotional events such as public mourning or celebration bring together crowds much louder, much aggressive, tenuous, and destructive than the conventional flash mobs. The transient illegality that flash mobs produce then is perhaps a way of re-enchanting the city. What do the mobsters do when they come together for a flash mob? That's probably a wrong question to ask. While the actions of the mobsters might be bizarre and lacking in meaning, often uninformed by the obvious ideology, flash mobs do produce a new mode of signification and networking pattern that redefines our imaginations of who are the communities that occupy a city. The ephemeral nature of the flash mob, the improbably pseudonymous identities of the participants, the technology-mediated communication, and the networking patterns all hint towards a re-enchantment where the social world around us is profoundly affected by the technologies that we adopt. In these unexpected eruptions, so to speak, flash mobs create a new relationship between actors, audience, and the spaces that they inhabit, including all these three into the circuits of digital technologies. As a form of radical localized performance, flash mobs offer a way to question the hierarchical intentionality of the spaces that they transform. They embody new ways in which technologies interface with our daily life, producing new forms of enchanted living. Thank you.